Okay, good morning everyone. So again, we'll start elementary number theory and methods of proof. As I said earlier, this is one of the most important branches of mathematics, and many people actually dedicate their life to prove properties about numbers, about integers, about real numbers, about rational numbers. And next time, actually, we cover another very interesting part of mathematics, sequences. And we'll prove properties about these sequences. And we'll see that basically there are a lot of different issues in this part of mathematics, which are still unproven. And you can still basically prove them if you work for a very long time in this area. We'll see conjectures that are basically properties that are assumed to be true, but they are not yet proven, like the Goldbeck conjecture, the Collins conjecture, and so on. So we'll start with number theory and methods of proof. So what exactly is number theory? Are actually all the properties of integers, whole numbers, rational numbers, which are basically fractions of two integers, and real numbers. And the reason why we covered logic in the previous two lectures was really that we learned methods of proof to prove such statements in number theory, in other branches of mathematics. So we'll use the ways that we learned, the methods of proof that we learned in the previous two lectures, to actually prove the truth of mathematical statements. For example, consider the definition of a floor of a real number. For any real number x, the floor of x, which we use this notation for symbolizing the floor, is the largest integer that is less than or equal with x. So for instance, the floor of 2.3 is 2, is the integer part of that positive number. Because if you represent this number on the real axis, you will see that to the left of 2.3, which is a real number, there is the integer 2, is the number, the first integer less than equal with 2.3. The floor of 12.99999 is basically, it doesn't matter how close is that real number to the next integer. It can be right next to 13, but in this case, the floor will be the number, the integer number that is less than equal with that number. So in this case, it will be 12, because that's actually the integer part of this number. And the floor of minus 1.5 is minus 2. And the reason why is that this negative number is basically above, it's greater than equal with minus 2. And there is no other, minus 1 is actually not less than equal with minus 1.5. It's, if you again represent it on the real numbers, on the negative axis, you will basically see that on the negative part, you will see that minus 1.5 has as floor minus 2. So again, the reason why we learned logic is that we want to prove properties of numbers and other areas of mathematics. And one such property is that for any real number x, the floor of x minus 1 is equal with the floor of x minus 1. And we'll actually prove this property later today. It's actually a universal statement. You can see that the variable is in the domain of real numbers. And then we basically have a mathematical formula that will prove using the definition of basically real of the floor for real numbers. Then there will be properties that will disprove. We'll basically start with an assumption. Is this property correct? And in this case, to this universal statement, we only have to give a counterexample. So here, the statement is for any real numbers, x and y, the floor of x minus y is equal with the floor of x minus the floor of y. And the question is this a real, is this a true property? And the answer is really no, this is a false property. And I can give you an infinite number of such examples, but in fact, we only need one. And we can take, for instance, 2.0 minus 1.1, the floor of that will be the floor of 0.9, which is equal with 0, the integer part of that positive real number. Or I can give you, or I can, and I can show you that the floor of 2.0 is 2, and the floor of 1.1 is 1, and the difference between the two floors is 1, which is different than the floor of the difference. So as you can see, one example disproves that universal statement. And we'll use other methods of proof for existential statements, for the negation of existential statements. We will use the proof by contradiction, proof by contraposition, and so on. So we'll start with properties of integers, then we'll prove properties of rational numbers, and then properties of real numbers. And for all of them, we'll prove using the methods of proof that we learned in the logic of quantified statements. So let's see an example of a proof. And we'll start with basic arithmetics. So, and the example that we want to prove is if x is a number with 5 multiplied with x plus 3 is equal with 33, what is the value of x? And in this case, the statement says that if this assumption is true, that x is a number and 5x plus 3 is equal with 33, does this imply that x is equal with 6? And again, we'll basically start by assuming that the statement is true. So if 5x plus 3 is equal with 33, then we can subtract 3 out of both parts of this equality. We know that the equality must still hold in case that you subtract the same value from both sides. So in this case, we actually get 5x plus 3 minus 3 is equal with 33 minus 3, which simplifies to 5x, because 5x plus 3 minus 3 is equal to 5x, because you are subtracting 3 and adding 3, and those two cancel each other. And on the right-hand side, we have 33 minus 3 is equal with 30. So now the equality becomes 5x is equal with 30. That x, that is a new property, in fact, that x is a number which multiply with 5 is equal with 30. Now, again, we can do the same thing. We can divide both sides of this equality with 5. And now we'll get that the only possible equality that we get is x is equal with 6. So this is actually a proof that we proved using steps. And we'll see that these kind of proofs are quite common even when we prove universal statements about numbers in number theory. So sometimes we'll have to use multiple steps, different steps, prove a universal statement, prove an existential statement, prove by contradiction, and so on, in different steps to prove a complex property. Now, we start with the properties of equality. Very simple set of properties, and we'll want to build incrementally of additional properties that are true about numbers, and then we'll prove more complex properties. And the properties of equality that we consider to be correct are that a number is equal with itself. So for any a being a number, or in fact any kind of quantity, a is equal with a. Similarly, we have the commutativity of equality. If a is equal with b, then b is also equal with a. And finally, transitivity of equality. If a is equal with b and b is equal with c, then a is equal with c. And the set of all numbers is closed under addition, subtraction, and multiplication. In particular, the set of integers, because we'll start with properties of integers. So what does it mean that the set of all numbers or integers is closed under addition, subtraction, and multiplication? Is that two numbers added, two integers, if we add two integers, then the sum of those two integers is also an integer. Similarly, the subtraction of an integer minus an integer is also an integer, and simply similarly multiplication. So really, I should actually extend this stating, for instance, for any integers a and b, a plus b is also an integer. Okay. And similarly for multiplication and subtraction. Now, this is not true for division, as you can actually see that 1 divided by 2 is not an integer, is 0.5, which is a rational number or a real. Basically, it's a real. Reals include all rational numbers. Okay. But the rest of the operations, addition, subtraction, and multiplication, give you also integers. So this is a property that we will use for the rest of the lecture. And now we start with the real properties of numbers. So an integer n is even if and only if n equals twice some other integer. So in logic, we would write it as a universal statement. For all integers, n is even if and only if there exists an integer k such that n is equal with 2k. And actually, I'm using an implicit universal quantifier. We actually talked about this when we talked about predicate logic. We don't specify that we are talking in this case about for all integers, but we are stating that property above, that this is about integers. So an even number is really a number that can be written as 2 multiplied with k for another integer k. And this is important to remember as a property of integers, because if we want to prove other properties about numbers, we'll use this definition. So this is a definition. It defines that n is even if and only if it's equal with twice some other integer. Similarly, a number n is odd, an integer n is odd, if and only if n equals twice some integer plus 1. And again, we write it in the logic of quantified statements. N is odd if and only if there exists an integer k such that n is equal with 2k plus 1. Okay? And this is for all integers again. We have the implicit universal B implication. Now, we'll basically want to show simple examples that are even or odd. So the first question is 0 an even number? And the answer is yes, because for 0, I can find another integer 0. That multiply with 2 is equal with 0. Is minus 301 an odd number? And again, the answer is that yes, because minus 301 can be written as 2 multiplied with an integer, which is minus 151 plus 1, which actually gives us minus 301. Because the multiplication gives us minus 302 plus 1 is minus 301. Now we have a universal statement. Is it true that for all integers, if a and b are integers, then 5 multiplied with a squared multiplied with b is an even number? So first of all, we know from the fact that integers are closed under multiplication that 6 multiplied with a squared multiplied with b is an integer, okay? So now we'll basically have to prove using the definition of an even number. So a number is even if and only if it's equal with an integer k multiplied with 2. Okay. So now we can actually break 6 into 2 multiplied with 3, which actually lets us group through associativity of multiplication as the original number 6a squared multiply with b as 2 multiplied with 3a squared multiply with b. But from the fact that integers were closed under multiplication, 3 multiplied with a squared multiply with b is an integer because it's a product of integers 3a, a, and b, which are all integers. Therefore, that number is indeed even because it can be written as 2 multiplied with an integer. Okay. Let's prove more complicated properties of numbers. Now, the next definition defines a prime number. Prime numbers are very special numbers in computer science. They are used in encryption, in public private key encryption, for encoding a message on one agent and sending it through a public network to another agent. Only if that second agent has the key to decrypt that message can be decrypted. And the entire area of public private key encryption is basically based on prime numbers, very large prime numbers, and the fact that factorization can only be done, it's very complicated to be done. In order to find all the prime factors of a number and actually find if a number is prime, is very expensive. However, decrypting the messages is very cheap if you already have the key, if you already have the prime numbers that are factors of some other number. So let's actually define what a prime number is. So an integer n is prime if and only if n is greater than 1, so 1 is not a prime number, and for all positive integers r and s, if n is equal with r and s, then either r or s equal n. So basically, this is the standard definition of prime numbers. All positive numbers, a prime number is a positive number such that is greater than 1, and for all positive integers r and s, then either if r, n is equal with r multiply with s, then either r or s equals n. Okay, and we've write it in logic as follows: n is a prime number if and only if for all positive integers r and s, if n is equal with r multiply with s, then either s is equal with n and r is equal with 1, or r is equal with n and s is equal with 1. Okay. Then the opposite of a prime number is a composite number. A number n, an integer n, is composite if and only if n is greater than 1 and n is equal with r multiply with s, for some integers r and s, where r is strictly less than n and strictly greater than 1, and s is strictly greater than 1 and strictly less than n. And again, if we write it in logic, it will be n is a composite if and only if there exist positive integers r and s, such that n is the product of r and s, and both r and s are greater than 1 and less than n. Now, the first property that we'll try to prove for number theory is every integer greater than 1 either prime or composite? And the answer is yes. So this is a universal statement, and we'll actually have to prove it using the definitions and the methods of proof in logic. So let n be an integer greater than 1. So this is actually proved by case. Basically, you are giving a generic case, which is n greater, an integer greater than 1. And there exist at least two pairs of integers r is equal with n and s is equal with 1. And r is equal with 1 and s is equal with n, such that n is equal with r multiply with s. So we have that there exists at least one pair, no? At least two pairs, in fact, which is n and 1. If there exists a pair of positive integers r and s such that n is equal with r and s, and neither r nor s equal either 1 or n, basically the definition of composite numbers, then n is composite. Otherwise, it's prime. So basically, what we are doing here is proving that property by cases. Instead of proving that the number is either composite or prime, we're actually stating explicitly that if that logical property, which is actually the definition of composite numbers, is true for that number, then it's a composite number. And if that logical property is not true, then it's a prime number. We already proven the existence of such products. We basically said that we start with r is 1 and s is n. So we already proven that basically there exists such pairs. Now we are basically leaving this to the specific number if this property is true or false. Because it doesn't matter if the property is true or the property is false, it implies basically one part of that disjunction. It implies that the number is either composite or that proves that the number is prime. Later today, we'll actually prove that these two sets are disjoint. They don't have a prime, number is either prime or composite. But now we only proved the inclusive disjunction of this property. We proved that it's at least one of the two cases. We didn't state yet that these two sets are disjoint. They cannot actually overlap. There is no number that is composite and prime at the same time. Okay? So now, what kind of statements we can prove for number theory? We can prove existential statements, universal statements, then we can prove disprove existential statements and universal statements. We'll start with proving existential statements, then we'll go to proving universal statements, and then continue with the other type of statements later. So, proving an existential statement, proving a statement of the form there exists an X in the domain D such that Q of X is true if and only if Q of X is true for at least one element in the domain. And there are two types of proofs that usually are done for such existential statements. There are constructive proofs of existence. That basically means you find an element X in the domain that makes Q of X true, or you give a direct set of instructions for finding such an element X. And then there are non-constructive proofs of existence, where you prove that such a property actually is possible to be proven, but you don't actually find the element. Those are much harder, and usually they are covered in more complex classes or more advanced classes in mathematics. So in our case, we'll actually deal with constructive proofs of existence. We are given a property, and we actually have to find the element or one of the elements that proves that property. And we already actually proven such statements before for that equation, little equation that we had before. But let's actually prove one such statement. So we are given the statement that exists an even integer n that can be written in two ways as a sum of two prime numbers. Now, in order to prove it, we'll have to find such pairs of two prime numbers such that they are equal with the even integer n. So the proof for this existential statement is a constructive proof. We actually have to find such pairs. So for instance, let's take n equal with 10. There exists an integer n. And 10 can be written as 5 plus 5. And 5 is a prime number, or it can be written as 10 plus 7, 3 and 3 plus 7. 3 and 7 are both prime numbers. So it's true that there exists an even integer n that can be written in two ways as sums of prime numbers. And you can find other examples. For n equal 12, you can try to find two prime numbers that summed and two sets of prime numbers that basically summed give you that number and so on. But it is an existential statement, so you have to prove it for one element, and only basically one would suffice to prove that an existential statement. Let's go to the next property. There exists an integer k such that 22 multiply with r plus 18 multiply with s, where r and s are integers, is equal with 2 multiply with k. Okay? Now, we can still give a constructive proof of existence even if we don't actually give an actual element in the domain. So in this case, we can actually see that if we divide this equation with 2, we get that the right-hand side of the original equation is k is equal with 11 multiplied with r plus 9 multiplied with s. Now, if r and s are integers, because of the fact that integers are closed under multiplication and addition, k must also be an integer. So we can see that we said that products of integers are integers and sums of integers are also integers. Therefore, k must be an integer no matter what r and s you give as examples as integers. Okay? So this is also a constructive proof of existence. You gave directions of how to find the element that you are looking for that existential statement, but you didn't have to give such an example, okay? You can, if you want. You can take r is 0, s is 0, and then k will be 0. So yes, such a k can be found for an r and s. But this is basically an existential statement. I can pose this as a universal statement, but that's the topic of the next type of proofs that we can prove. Okay? So basically, we'll go to the next type of statements. Non-constructive proof of existence are much harder to prove for existential proofs. So the evidence for the existence of X is guaranteed by some axioms of or theorem, and the assumption that the assumption that such an X doesn't exist will lead to a contradiction. However, the problem of such non-constructive proofs of existence is that it gives you no idea of what X is. So we will not cover it in this class. So there are existential proofs that are proven without actually building the element or the algorithm to find that element. But they are much more complex, and they are actually not that useful in the type of proofs that we have in this class. Okay, now, before I show you how to prove universal statements, let's talk about disproving universal statements. Remember that a universal statement, if we apply the negation to a universal statement, we get an existential statement. Disproving universal statements is equivalent with proving the negation of universal statements, which will become an existential statement. For that existential statement, we saw that a constructive proof is actually to give an example. So now, disproving universal statement can be done by an example to the existential statement, that is the negation of that universal statement. So let's do it formally. So let's assume that we have a universal statement. There exists an X in a domain, and this can be a number, such that for all X in a domain, if P of X is true, then Q of X is true. And we want to disprove it. And such a statement is false, is equivalent with its negation to be true by the definition of an example of the negation of a universal statement. But now the negation is an existential statement. So basically, it exists X in the domain D such that the negation of that implication is P of X and not Q of X. That's the negation of P of X implies Q of X. And proving the negation of that universal statement, which is an existential statement, is done with an example, constructive proof. So that is called disproof by counterexample. Given a universal statement for all X in the domain D, P of X implies Q of X, is false if we find a value X in the domain D such that P of X is true and Q of X is false. And that X, if we find it, is called a counterexample. For instance, let's disprove that for all real numbers a and b, if a square is equal with b square, then a is equal with b. And in fact, you can do this for all integer numbers a and b. Okay. Now, this property is actually false, because I can give you two real numbers, a and b. A is equal with 1, and b is equal with minus 1, such that the square between the square of a is equal with the square of b. A square is equal with b square, but a is different than b. So we basically see that a square is equal with b square is p of x in this case, and a is equal with b has as a negation not a is equal with b. So in fact, we used the conjunction between the premise and the negation of the conclusion of that implication. So we disproved the universal statement by showing a counterexample that that universal statement cannot be true. Now, proving universal statements. So we are given a universal statement for all x in the domain D, p of x implies q of x. Now, if D is finite, then we can enumerate through all of the elements and show that the property is true for every element in the domain. So if D is finite, or there is only a number of finite number of elements that for which p of x is true, then we can try all possibilities, which basically is applied below. So if we want to prove the property that for all numbers n, if n is an integer, if n is even, then and n is greater than or equal with 4 and less than or equal with 7, then x can be written as the sum of two prime numbers, can be proven by enumerating all the elements for which the premise is true. So the premise is true for only two elements. If we are looking between n greater than or equal with 4 and n less than or equal with 7, we have the numbers 4, 5, 6, and 7. 4 and 6 are even numbers. We were also told that n must be an even number. So now the question becomes, is this universal property true for 4 and for 6? And we can look at 4 and see that 4 can be written as the sum of 2 plus 2. And 6 can be written as the sum of 3 plus 3. So now we know that for every element in that domain, basically, if the number is even and it's between 4 and 7, then it can be written as the sum of two prime numbers. So we prove this universal statement even if the domain is infinite, because the premise is only true for a finite number of elements, by exhaustively trying all of the elements in that range, because we cannot see in that domain, because the domain is infinite. The integers is an infinite set. Okay. However, if we want to prove universal statements, for an infinite number of elements, we have a very limited number, a set of proofs that we can use. And the proof that we discuss about today is called the proof of generalizing from a generic particular. Next class, we'll also learn proof by induction. Basically, a property will be true even for an infinite number of elements if we can prove that it's true for a base case. And then we can prove that if it's true for some, let's say, integer n, is definitely true for the integer n plus 1. And that will propagate to infinity, to all of the following numbers in the whole set of integers. However, today we prove it in a different way. We prove using generalizing from a particular. And this is very steep to learn at the beginning. Basically, it's kind of like the proving through an example, but you have to choose a generic element, any possible element in the domain. Okay, so we say the following phrase: suppose x is a particular but arbitrary chosen element of the set. Now we show that X satisfies that property. The whole point of this kind of proof is that there is no special assumption about X that are not true for all of the other elements of the domain. So that's what it means arbitrary chosen, an element that is chosen arbitrary and is not a specific example. We still leave it as the variable X. We don't change it to, let's say, 2 or 3 or 5. We don't choose actually an element. We just choose an element and we say this is true for a particular arbitrary chosen element. So the method of direct proof has the following steps. For all X in the domain D, if P of X is true, then Q of X is true. These are the type of statements that we will try to prove through the method of direct proof. So the method of the direct proof is a specific example of the methods of generalizing from a generic particular. Those type of methods do not have a specific form of the logical formula that you are trying to prove. Only in the case of the method of direct proof, we have a specific universal implication statement. Now, in this kind of case, let X be a particular but arbitrary chosen element of the domain for which the hypothesis P of X is true. So we basically take an element in the domain for which P of X is true. But this is arbitrary chosen. We still leave it at SX. We are not going to instantiate it with any specific element in that domain. Now, we will show that Q of X must also be true, that conclusion must also be true. And this makes it basically the entire universal implication true, because basically it shows that for all of the X's for which P of X is true, Q of X is also implied to be true. So let's take an example. It's always good to take an example and actually use this type of method. Okay, let's see. I heard the beep. Probably what's happening is that somebody is trying to join without being in the domain at stonybrook.edu. So again, you must be in the domain in order to join. Okay, so the property that we want to prove is that the sum of any two even integers is an even number. So we formalize it as for all integers m and n, if m and n are even numbers, that m, then m plus n is also an even number. Okay, and we start exactly with the steps that we had for the method of direct proof. Suppose m and n are any even integers. So basically, we take the premise of this implication, m and n are even integers. Now we have existential instantiation. So remember that universal statements, in order to prove for a specific case, you instantiate it for a specific element. So if the existence of a certain kind of object is assumed or has been deduced, then it can be given a name. So since m and n are even numbers, even integers, they must equal some twice some other integers. And we can give names to those integers. So m is equal with 2 multiply with r for some integer r, and n is equal with 2 multiply with s for some integer s. Those were by the definitions of even numbers. Basically, we said that an even number is 2 multiplied some integer. And now we gave a name to that integer r, or we gave a name s. Now the sum of m plus n is 2r plus 2s, the two values. But we can use distributivity of multiplication of addition over addition to actually show that this is equal with 2 multiplied with r plus s. R plus s is an integer because integers are closed under addition. The sum of any two integers is also an integer. So now we have that n plus n is 2 multiplied with an integer, which is exactly the definition of even numbers. A number is even if and only if it's 2 multiplied with some other integer. So m plus n is an even number. So now that example can be formalized as the proven theorem, the proof theorem. So that proof theorem is the one above. For every integers m and n, if m and n are even, then m and n plus n is also an even number. Now, there are a lot of pitfalls that one can fall into when they try to prove properties using the methods of generalizing from generic particulars, in particular for the method of direct proof. And I want to go over this common type of mistakes. First type of mistake is arguing from examples. So the method of generalizing from a particular supposes an arbitrary element, but it doesn't instantiate it to any value. So instantiating it to an actual value, like 2 or 3 or 5 or 2.5 and so on, is a mistake, because you basically want to prove this universal statement for every value in the domain. So you cannot argue from specific examples. You give an example that this property holds for 2, therefore it must be true for all other integers. No, you can't prove that if it's true in a particular case, it's true in all cases. Another common mistake is using the same letter to mean two different things, two different variables. So in the you don't have to use the same variables that we use in the definitions. I've seen in the past when I taught this class before that, let's say that you had a variable in the problem k, but then for some other variable in the same problem, you use namely the same variable k from the definition of even. So you state that, oh, this is an even number, it will be equal with 2 multiplied with k. But that k is a different k than the one that you had in the original problem. So make sure that if you do use variables to prove the some statements, you use new variables every time you have new variables. Jumping to a conclusion, jumping steps. So in the previous problem, without actually showing the definitions of real number of integers and even numbers, you just jump from the premise to the conclusion. If m and n are even, then m plus n is even. No, you have to use only the properties that were true before in order to prove the new properties. Okay, so what we did have before, we had the properties of equality, the fact that integers are closed under multiplication and addition and also subtraction, and that's it, and the definitions of even basically. So don't jump to conclusions. We need complete proofs. Basically take the properties that we learned about in the lecture and use them, use those properties and only those properties to prove new properties. You cannot jump to a conclusion without a justification that leads back to the definitions or the axioms that were already proven or considered true. Circular reasoning. So sometimes you are given a statement, if P of X is true, then Q of X is true. But instead of basically starting from P of X, I've seen cases when someone would start from Q of X, assuming Q of X is true, and then through some sequence of steps, inferring that Q of X is true. So basically you can't prove circularly X is true because Y is true, since X is true itself. Okay, that basically you rely on the proof, on the justification of a property on itself. Confusion between what is known and what is still to be known. So every time you try to prove a property like the one that we tried to prove before, state explicitly in logic What is the premise and what is the conclusion? So now you can actually choose in this method of proof to actually prove from the premise that conclusion. So always see what is known, premises or axioms and proved theorems. Basically in our class is those theorems that are in the lecture notes can be used to prove additional properties. Use of any rather than some. So any means for all and some means just exists. There exists some elements for which we prove. So sometimes you have to prove universal statements and you have to use any. Any really means all, in at least in our lecture notes. Some really means exists. So I will try my best to use all instead of any, because any is a bit it's a bit ambiguous in English. For any element it means for all, but in some instances any really means some. So you have to be very careful when you use any to actually respond to the right question. And finally, misuse of if. Misuse of if is again related to confusion between what is known and what is still to be known. Which part is assumed to be true and you want to prove that conclusion, and which is the conclusion, not to start in the wrong way. Okay, showing that an existential statement is false reduces to a universal statement is true. Because the negation of an existential statement is a universal statement. So proving that an existential statement is false, we must prove that its negation, which is a universal statement, is true. And again, there are different ways to prove universal statements. In most cases, we will use the method of direct proof or method of generalizing from a particular in general. Or we use exhaustive searches, and in that case, basically, we have to exhaustive proofs. We have to prove it for all of the elements in the finite domain or the finite set of elements for which the premise of an implication is true. So let's take an example. We prove that the following statement, which is an existential statement, is false. There is a positive integer n, such that n squared plus 3n plus 2 is a prime number. Now, first thing that we need to do in order to disprove that existential statement is construct its negation. So the negation of this, there exists a positive integer such that the number is prime, is for all positive integers, that number is not prime, n squared plus 3n plus 2. So now it's a universal statement, and we are stating it that for all positive integers. So let's choose any positive integer. And for any such positive integer, in fact, n squared plus 3n plus 2 is n plus 1 multiplied with n plus 2. And actually, you can see that because n plus 1 multiplied with n plus 2 is n squared plus 2n plus n plus 2. So it's n squared plus 3n plus 2, where n plus 1, because n is a positive integer, must be greater than 1. So n is strictly greater than 0. N plus 1, if you add both sides of that inequality with 1, is n plus 1 is greater than 1. Similarly, n plus 2 is greater than 1, because n was greater than equal with 1, basically is greater than 0. And therefore, n plus 2 is greater than 1. We can see that if n plus 1 is greater than 1, and 1 is greater than 0, n plus 1 is greater than 0, we can add to that 1, and we get n plus 2 is greater than 1. Thus, n squared plus 3n plus 2 is the product of two integers greater than 1. Which makes it a non-prime number by the definition of composite numbers. But we leave it in this form because we haven't yet stated the property that composite numbers are not prime. We just showed in this case that that number is not prime, because it doesn't satisfy the definition of prime numbers that for all such products, both now one of the numbers is equal with n itself. Okay, before we go to rational numbers, let's see if there are any questions about integer numbers in the chat. So, any questions? Okay, so Salem, you're asking about the first example where you had to prove there exists some even number that can be written in two ways, such as a sum of prime numbers. Is there a way to easily solve this problem without having to try a bunch of even numbers until you find the answer? No. So for existential statements, sometimes you don't find such elements easily. And actually, next class, we learned sequences, and you have to guess what is the general form for a sequence. And you're given a couple of elements, and really what you try to find is, from your experience, what can be the general formula to give you the elements in that sequence. Similarly, in our case, you will start trying examples. So you will start two, can be written as the sum of two other even numbers. No, you can actually immediately see that is 1 plus 1 is the only two, and actually you can also use negative numbers, but those are not definitely prime, and one is not a prime number. So you start incrementally and you see, no, this is not the case. Then you go to the next number, 4, 2 plus 2, but there is no other two sets of two prime numbers. Then you go to 6 and you see that you may or may not find, and so on. So you need to try it. Existential statements really require a lot of practice to find the examples that prove it. Similarly, for counterexamples, in fact, you have to find the examples that prove the existential statement that is the negation of that universal statement. If it seems like if I haven't been given the answer, then the question would have taken me some time to figure it out. Yes, and that's why these homeworks that I post are quite long, not really to learn basically different types of methods of proof, but actually practice the same type of method of proof multiple times. So some, you will see that there is one way to prove a statement and you have to solve 2 or 3 up to 5 problems in that area. So, and really the reason why I gave them all in that area is to see that you are able to memorize that method of proof and use it in multiple contexts, in a different context. Okay, so let's see if there are other questions. So I will watch this for the next 2 minutes, and maybe we'll take a 2 minutes break. We already covered an hour, so an hour and a half almost. So let's take a 2 minutes break and see if there are other questions coming through chat, and then we continue with the properties of rational numbers. Okay, so let's wait for 1 minute and watch the chat in case that there are other questions posted. Okay, so since there are no additional questions, let's continue with the properties of rational numbers. So a real number, R, is a rational number if and only if it can be expressed as the quotient of two integers with a non-zero denominator. So R is rational if and only if there exists two integers a and b such that r is equal with a divided by b and b is different than 0. For instance, 10 divided by 3 is a rational number. It's 3.3 in a period. Minus 5 divided by 39 is a rational number. It's basically the integer minus 5 and divided by the integer 39. 0.281 is a rational number. It can be written as 281 divided by 1000. So all of these rational numbers of this kind can be written basically by divisions to powers of 10 of the integer that basically represents the digits after the decimal point divided by basically how many digits we want to extract. 7, any integer can be written as a rational number. It's 7 divided by 1. 100 will be 100 divided by 1. 0 can be written as 0 divided by 1. And you can actually see now that this is an existential statement. There exist integers a and b such that r is equal with a divided by b and b is different than 0. But it's not universal. We just have to find one such pair. So for 0, I can find the pair 0 and 1. But there are actually an infinite number of such pairs. 0 divided by any other integer but 0 is 0. So I can find 0 divided by 2, 0 divided by 3, 0 divided by 4, and so on for a very long time. 0 divided by 1, 2 in a period, which is 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, and so on, is actually 12 divided by 99. It's actually a rational number itself. Every integer is basically a rational number. For instance, n can be written as n divided by 1. So this is the definition of a rational number. And now we'll try to prove properties about rational numbers. A sum of rational numbers is rational. And we write it in logic for any two real numbers R and S. If R and S are rational numbers, then R plus S is also a rational number. And we are going to use the method of direct proof. Suppose R and S are particular but arbitrarily chosen real numbers such that R and S are rational. So the premise of that implication is true. By definition and existential instantiation, we get that R is equal with A divided by B and S is equal with C divided by D for some integers A, B, C, and D. And B is different than 0 and D is different than 0. The denominators in both rations are different than 0. So now R plus S, the sum of those two rational numbers, is A divided by B plus C divided by D. But a fraction is equal with the fraction of the denominator divided by multiply with the same number divided by the denominator multiply with the same number. So we can multiply the ratio on the left-hand side with D. So it's A multiply with D divided by B multiply with D, and the ratio on the right-hand side with a B. So it will be B multiply with C divided by B multiply with D. So now we can actually rewrite the fraction with a common denominator. So we are getting A multiply with D plus B multiply with C divided by B multiply with D by adding the fractions with the common denominator. But now A multiply with D plus B multiply with C is an integer because integers are closed under multiplication and addition. A multiply with D is an integer, b multiplied with c is an integer, and their sum is an integer. Similarly, b multiplied with d is an integer. Moreover, b multiplied with d is different than zero, because both b and d were different than zero. And if both of them are different than zero, their product cannot be zero. That's a different property that we can actually prove later, that if both numbers are different than zero, their product is different than zero. Therefore, by definition of rational, r plus s is also a rational number. It's exactly the definition. That's r plus s is an integer divided by an integer, and the denominator is different than zero. So the property is proven, exactly what we wanted to prove, by the method of direct proof. Okay. So let's see another property. And again, if we have properties that are proven before, we can use them in proving the current property. Okay. So we proved a couple of properties before, but there are similar proofs for other properties that we will see below. What we want to do is to find a method similar to the symbolic proofs that we had in the case of the logic of compound statements that takes us from proving one basically new theorem step by step to prove to basically reduce it to proofs that we saw before. So this is very similar to the symbolic proofs that we did in the logic of compound statements. We derive additional new results about even and odd integers using the properties that we proved before. So let's assume that we want to prove that if a is any even integer and b is any odd integer, then a squared plus b squared plus 1 divided by 2 is also an integer. And we want to use only these properties. The sum, product, and difference of any two integers are even integers are even. We actually proved that the sum of two even integers is an even number as earlier. Then the sum of and the difference of any two odd integers is also even. That's another property that can be proven in the same way that we proved the first one with the method of the generalizing from particulars. Then the product of any two odd integers is an odd number. The product of any even integer and any odd integer is an even number. The sum of any odd integer and any even integer is an odd number. The difference of any odd integer minus any even integer is an odd number. The difference of any even integer minus any odd integer is an odd number. So we want to use these properties to prove the one above. Okay. So how can we do that? First, method of direct proof. Suppose that the premise is true. A is an arbitrary chosen even integer. B is an arbitrary chosen odd integer. By property 3, that was stating that the product of two odd numbers is an odd number, b squared is an odd number. By property 1, that the product of an even number with any other number is an even number, we get that a squared is an even number because it's a multiplied with a. By property 5, that states that the sum of an odd number with an even number is an odd number, we infer that a squared plus b squared is an odd number. But by property number 2, that the sum of an odd number with an odd number is an even number, we also get that a squared plus b squared plus 1 is an even number. By the definition of even, a squared plus b squared plus 1 must be equal with 2 multiplied with an integer. Basically, the definition of integer said that a number is an even number if and only if there exists an integer k such that that number is equal with 2 multiplied with k. So this equality was obtained using the properties that we saw before. Now we can divide both sides of this equality with 2, which keeps basically the same equality. And we get that a squared plus b squared plus 1 divided by 2 is equal with k. But k was an integer, and therefore we've proven what we had to prove. So these are very similar to the symbolic proofs that we actually talked about before. I will leave for actually the presentation part to prove any one of these properties. We already proved one of the properties that the sum of two even numbers is also an even number. But any one of these properties can be chosen to prove it, okay? And in fact, why not? Let's take 5 minutes to prove one of the properties. Do you have any preference? Which one do you want to prove? And then I will show you how to prove it. You can either say or chat or put it in the chat. And if I don't see it in the next 10 seconds, I will just choose one. Probably the last one is probably the most extensive. Okay, so let's choose one. We take property number 7 and we'll prove it step by step. So let me increase the size a little bit. So for any integers, and we'll actually enumerate them. So for any integers, let's call them x and y. The difference between any even integer minus any odd integer is odd. So we write it if x is even and y is odd, then x minus y is odd. So, method of direct proof. Let x and y be any integers such that x is even and y is odd. And actually, we can actually add here the magic phrase, arbitrary chosen. So really, it means any such x and y with that property. Okay. So now, by the fact that x is even, we infer that there exists k such that x is equal with 2 multiplied with k. By the property that y is odd, we infer that there exists an integer L, we have to use a different variable, such that y is equal with 2L plus 1. Okay, now x minus y becomes 2k minus 2L plus 1. Which is equal with 2k minus 2L minus 1. But we can actually add and subtract 1. So minus 1 plus 1, it's 0, no? So we can actually subtract 1 again and add 1 to that, and it's still the same value. Now, Basically, this is 2k minus 2l minus 2 plus 1. But that is equal with, now we can give 2 as a common factor, 2k minus l minus 1 plus 1. But this number is an integer because integers were closed under fraction. Therefore, x minus y is an odd number. A definition of odd. It's 2 multiplied with an integer plus 1. So any one of these properties can be proven in a few steps using basically the method of direct proof to be true. And basically here we use something similar to symbolic proofs, step by step using the properties that were known, prove a more complex property. Since there are no questions, let's continue. Let's make sure that, do you still hear me and see my screen? Yes, thank you very much. Okay, good. Okay, so now divisibility is a more complex property, and you saw the reason is that it's not closed on for integers. We can see that 1 divided by 2 is not an integer. But so division is not doesn't keep the number in the same domain, but divisibility is a different property. We basically state that if n and d are integers and d is different than 0, then we say that n is divisible by d if and only if n equals d times some integer. So d divides n, or d is one of the divisors of n, if and only if there exists an integer k such that n is equal with d multiplied with k. And we actually say it in different ways. We can say it that n is a multiple of d, or d is a factor of n, or d is a divisor of n, or d divides n. And the notation is again d vertical bar n, which is read as d divides n. So for instance, 21 is divisible by 3, or 3 is a divisor of 21, or 3 divides 21. 32 is a multiple of minus 16. Again, minus 16 multiplied with minus 2 is equal with 32. 5 divides 40, because we can always find the integer 8, such that 8 multiplied with 5 is equal with 40. 6 is a factor of 54. 9 multiplied with 6 is equal with 54. 7 is a factor of minus 7. Because 7 multiplied with minus 1, another integer, is minus 7. Any non-zero integer k divides 0, because 0 is equal with k multiplied with 0. So now let's prove properties for divisors. And the first property that we want to prove is that a positive divisor of a positive integer for all integers a and b, if a and b are positive and a divides b, then a must be less than equal with b. Suppose, again, by method of direct proof, that a and b are positive integers and a does divide b. Then by definition, there must exist some integer k such that b is equal with a multiplied with k. This is by definition of divides, that a divides b. 1 must be less than equal with k, because every positive integer is greater than equal with 1. multiplying both sides gives the same inequality. So one less than equal with k multiply with a, which was a positive integer, will give us that a is less than equal with k multiply with a. But k multiply with a is actually b. So we are getting that a is less than equal with b, since a was a positive number. And multiplying with a positive number an inequality gives you the same inequality with the same direction. So basically, a positive divisor of a positive number, if a and b are both positive and a divides b, then the divisor must be less than equal with the multiplier, the value of b. Transitivity of divisibility. For all integers a, b, and c, if a divides b and b divides c, then a divides c. Now, by definition of division, a divides b is equivalent with b is equal with a multiplied with r for some integer r. Similarly, b divides c means c is equal with b multiplied with s for some integer s. So c is equal with b multiplied with s, but we can replace b with the value a multiplied with r, with the value of b. So we are getting that c is equal with a multiplied with r multiplied with s. But by associativity of multiplication, this is equal with a multiplied with r multiplied with s. So therefore, and the fact that r multiplied with s is a product of integers and integers are closed under multiplication, we are basically getting that c is equal with a multiplied with an integer, which means that a is a divisor of c. So a divides c too. So this is another instance of proof by method of direct proof. Counterexamples and divisibility. Let's say that we are given the property and we want to prove it or disprove it for all integers a and b. If a divides b and b divides a, then a must be equal with b. Okay. Now, this is stated for all integers. That includes negative and positive integers. So we look at this property and we remember that there was a property before, 7 and minus 7, that 7 divides minus 7. And immediately we are thinking, but also minus 7 divides 7. Because you can multiply minus 7 with minus 1, another integer, and you're getting 7. And this is similar to the counterexample that we have here. Assume that a is equal with 2 and b is equal with minus 2. By definition of divisibility, a divides b, because 2 divides minus 2. You can basically multiply 2 with minus 1 and another integer, and you get minus 2. But also, b divides a, because minus 2 divides 2. You can multiply minus 2 with minus 1, and you're getting 2. However, a is different than b, since 2 is different than minus 2. So this statement is actually false. It's not true that for all integers a and b, if a divides b and b divides a, then a is equal with b. And the reason why is that you can find a number and its negative correspondent number, and both the number divides the negative version of that number, and vice versa. But the two numbers are obviously different because one is positive and the other one is negative. Therefore, that statement is false. It's a universal statement which we proved that is false using a counterexample. In fact, what we just did, we proved the negation of that universal statement, which is an existential statement. Next is one of the most important theorems of number theory, the unique factorization of integers theorem. Given any integer n greater than 1, there exists a positive integer k, distinct prime numbers p1 up to pk, and the po and positive integers e1 to ek such that n is the product of p1 to the power e1 with p2 to the power e2 with p3 to the power e3 and so on to pk to the power ek. And any other expression for n as a product of prime numbers is identical to this except for the order in which the factors are written. Okay? The standard factored form, that's why it's called the unique factorization of integers, is that these prime numbers p1 to pk are sorted such that p1 appears first, p2 appears second, and so on up to pk. So given any integer, you can find a sequence of prime numbers in order, and the powers that these prime numbers have to be raised to, such that that product is unique. You are basically given a unique form called the standard factor form as the product of prime numbers that is that number n. Okay? Now, before I continue, before I basically prove all kinds of theorems using the unique factorization, let's do an exercise. So let's say that somebody tells you, give me the unique factorization of 100. But you can really choose any number in as basically numbers as an integer number. So first thing is to find what are the prime factors of 100. And one is 2. 2 divides 100, because you can write 100 just to show you as 50 multiplied with 2. Also, 5 divides 100. And again, because I can basically represent 100 as 5 multiplied with 20. Okay. Now, these are the prime factors of 100. But we can see that even after we divide by 2, 100, we get 50, which is actually 25 multiplied with 2. So 100 can be written as 2 to the power 2 plus. Also, if we divide by 5, we are actually getting 20, which is also a multiple of 5, is 4 multiplied with 5. So it's also 5 to the power 2. So this is the unique factorization of 100. 100 is 2 to the power 2 plus 5 to the power 2. So we found the prime numbers that divide 100, and we found the powers of those prime numbers. And again, as Salem actually mentioned, if you want to do this fast, you actually have to practice a lot, because this is actually a known hard problem. This is what the entire theory of secrecy, public private key encryption, stands on. Factoring numbers is hard. So you have to either see what are the prime numbers or iterate through all of the numbers from 2 to 100 and see if those numbers are divisors of 100. But basically, we are not going to go over such big numbers. You have to rely on your practice up to now of arithmetics to infer what's the correct way to factor numbers. So you basically have to see what are the prime factors of integers. Okay. So this is the unique factorization theorem. Basically, for any number, any integer number, positive integer number, you can find greater than 2, greater than equal with 2, you can find a unique factorization of that number in this form. Okay. Next, another theorem that we are going to cover are for the quotient and the remainder of division. So first of all, let's define what the quotient and the remainder of a division are. Given any integers n and positive integer d, there exists a unique integer. There exists unique integers q and r, such that n is equal with d multiply with q plus r, and r is greater than equal with zero and strictly less than d. And in fact, we are going to call n divided by d as the integer quotient obtained when n is divided by d. So that's actually this q that you see here, that's the quotient. And n modulo d is r, is the non-negative remainder obtained when n is divided by d. And the quotient remainder theorem tells us the following. N divided by d is the quotient, and n modulo d is the remainder, is equivalent by implication with n is equal with d multiplied with q plus r, and n modulo d is n minus d multiplied with n divided by d. So here you see an example. 54, it's 52 plus 2, which is 4 multiplied with 13 plus 2. So basically 54 divided by 4 gives us the quotient 13 and the remainder 2. And we can see that basically 13 is an integer. We multiply it with 4 gives us 52. And the remainder is greater than equal with 0, but strictly greater than 4. So given a number d, which is equal with 4, and an integer n, which is equal with 54, we can find the unique quotient and remainder for that division. Similarly, if we are given minus 54 and 4, again, we can write minus 54 as minus 56 plus 2. Minus 56 can be written as 4 multiplied with minus 14. And now we are basically getting the quotient minus 14 and the remainder 2. So really the quotient remainder theorem is that given any integer n and any positive integer d, there exists a unique integer q and a unique integer r such that n can be written as d multiplied with q plus r, and r is greater than or equal with 0 and strictly less than d. Okay. And we've wrote it using the two formulas below, that basically the quotient is q and the remainder is d, if and only if this formula is true, that n is d multiplied with q plus r, and n modulo d is n minus d multiplied with the remainder is n minus the product between the divisor and that quotient that we just computed. Now, I will show a couple of properties that we can prove with these previous theorems that we saw, but first let's revise another method of proof that we discussed in the previous two lectures. And that was the method of proof by division into cases. We used it both in proving direct properties or in the Quine method of proof. Basically, let's assume that we want to prove that the disjunction of A1 to AN implies C. In order to do that, we prove that if A1 is true, it follows C. If A2 is true, it follows C, and so on up to if AN is true, it follows C. So C is true regardless of which one of A1 to AN is true. If A1 or A2 up to AN is true, then it must be the case that C is true. Okay. So let's show an example. The parity of an integer refers to whether that integer is even and odd. And we want to prove the following property. Consecutive integers have opposite parity. Now there are two possible cases. Basically, we take an integer and that's the smallest of the integers, and then n plus 1 will be the next integer. The case one is that the smaller integer is even, or that the smaller integer is odd. In both cases, there are simple proofs. Basically, if the smaller of the two integers is even, then it can be written as 2k. The next integer is 2k plus 1, which is exactly the definition of an odd number. So after an even number follows an odd number. Now, let's assume that the smaller of the two integers is odd. Therefore, it can be written as 2k plus 1. Therefore, the following integer is 2k plus 2, which is 2 multiplied with k plus 1, which is an integer. Therefore, the second number is it's an even number. So the first number was odd, the second number is even. This proves that in either case that we chose, consecutive integers have opposite parity. If the first one is even, then the second one is odd. If the first one is odd, then the second one is even. Another example, any integer can be written in one of the four forms. N is equal with 4q, or n is equal with 4q plus 1, or n is equal with 4q plus 2, or n is equal with 4q plus 3. So now, basically, what we actually have here is a special case of the unique quotient remainder theorem. What we are saying is that any integer divided by 4 gives us a quotient integer and the remainder, which is 0, 1, 2, or 3. So it's really a special form of that theorem. Okay. By the quotient remainder theorem 2n, and the divisor is 4, we get that n is equal with 4 multiplied with q plus r, and 0 is less than equal with r, strictly less than 4. The only four possible non-negative remainders are basically between 0 and 4, not including 4, which are 0, 1, 2, and 3. Hence, basically, we have the four possibilities. So here is a conjunction of the n is equal with 4q plus r, and the disjunction of r is equal with 0, or r is equal with 1, or r is equal with 2, or r is equal with 3. Which basically gives us, if we distribute this conjunction over the disjunctions, four operands in the disjunctions. Is n is equal with 4q plus r, and r is equal with 0, which gives us n is equal with 4q, or n is equal with 4q plus r and r is equal with 1, which gives us n is equal with 4q plus 1, or n is equal with 4q plus 2, or n is equal with 4q plus 3 for some integer q, which actually proves our conclusion that any integer can be written in one of the four forms. Basically, that after division with 4, it gives us either 4 multiplied with an integer q, or 4 multiply with an integer q plus 1, or 4 multiply with an integer q plus 2, or 4 multiply with an integer q plus 3. Okay. And we will see part of the recitation today that we can prove this theorem for other numbers. Any integer can be written as, let's say, 3q or 3q plus 1 or 3q plus 2. Or any integer can be written as 2q or 2q plus 1, can be written as an even or an odd number. Now, we will talk about three more properties of integers: absolute values, and then floor and ceiling of integer numbers. Let's again take questions before we continue. So let's see if there are additional questions. I don't see additional questions. So again, let's take a 2 minutes break. And if you have any additional questions, please either put them here or just say them and or just write them, because it's easier to actually respond to them. So I'm waiting for questions for the next 2 minutes, and we take a 2 minutes break. Okay, so if there are no questions, let's return back to the lecture. Good. Okay, so let's define the absolute value of a number x. So that absolute value of a number x is x if x is greater than or equal with 0, or is minus x if x is less than 0. So the first property that we prove for absolute values is that for any real number r, r is greater than or equal with minus the absolute value of r and is less than or equal with the absolute value of r. Now there are two possible cases for r. If r is greater than or equal with 0, then the absolute value of r is equal with r, which basically shows that the absolute value of r is greater than or equal with r. And since the number is positive, this is greater than equal with the negative now any negative number, in particular minus the absolute value of r. If r is less than 0, then the absolute value of r is equal with minus r. So the absolute value of r is the positive value minus r, which is greater than any negative numbers, so it's greater than r. And the negative minus, if we multiply this equality with minus 1, we get minus the absolute value of r is equal with r itself. So r is greater than equal, in particular it's actually equal, with the minus the absolute value of r. So this property is true in both cases, positive numbers and negative numbers. Therefore, it's true for all real numbers, because we covered all the numbers from 0 included to infinity and less than 0 to infinity, minus infinity. Okay, the floor and ceiling of real numbers. The floor of a real number x, which we use this notation that we saw at the beginning of the lecture today, is the unique integer n such that n is less than or equal with x, which is strictly less than n plus 1. So the floor of x is equal with n if and only if this conjunction of two inequalities, x is greater than or equal with n and x is strictly less than n plus 1. And we can see it here. If x is a real number, including up to n, in fact, including n, n will be the integer to the left of that real number x, the first integer encountered on the real axis, on the left of that, left than equal to the number x. In fact, if it's equal, then x is the floor of x will be equal with x itself, and is less than, strictly less than n plus 1. X is strictly less than n plus 1. Similarly, the ceiling of any real number x using this notation, it's similar to floor, but we have the square part of the square bracket on the top of the value, is a unique integer n such that n minus 1 is strictly less than x, which is less than or equal with n. So basically, if x is a real number on the real axis, we are looking for the first integer that we see to the right of including x. So basically, we'll find the first integer to the right of x. And that's called the ceiling of x. So again, by definition, the ceiling of a real number x is n if and only if n is minus 1 is strictly less than x, which is less than or equal with n. So let's do a few examples. Like for instance, we know that 25 divided by 4 is 6.25. 6 is greater than 6.25 is greater than 6 and strictly less than 7. The floor of 6.25 is 6 and the ceiling of 6.25 is 7. 0.999 is greater than 0 but less than 1. So the floor of 0.999 is 0 and the ceiling of 0.999 is 1. Minus 2.01 is greater than minus 3 and strictly less than minus 2. So the floor of minus 2.01 is minus 3, and the ceiling of minus 2.01 is minus 2. So it doesn't matter how close is to the next integer, we are going to look at integers less than that number, less than equal with that number to find the floor. And similarly for ceiling, we are looking for numbers greater than equal with that number to find the ceiling. Okay. So now let's take properties of floor and ceiling. So we want to disprove a property of floor. We want to disprove that for all real numbers x and y, the floor of x plus y is equal with the floor of x plus the floor of y. And disproving is prove a universal statement is finding a counterexample. Basically proving with an example the negation of that universal statement, which is an existential statement. And that counterexample is x is equal with y is equal with 1 divided by 2. Because the floor of 1 divided by 2 plus 1 divided by 2 is the floor of 1, which is equal with 1 itself. But the floor of 1 divided by 2 plus the floor of 1 divided by 2 is 0 plus 0, which is equal with 0. So we can see that the floor of the sum is equal with 1, and the sum of the floors is equal with 0. So the property is not true. It's not true that for all real numbers, the floor of the sum is equal with the sum of the floors. Now, earlier Salemi was asking, okay, it's hard to find this kind of counterexamples. It comes with time and with experience, because we can actually see that any real number can be written as the integer part and then the fractional part of that real number. So here is an example. We are given the real number 2 3/5. So basically, we know, we can see that it has two parts. It has the integer part is 2, and then the value that is between 0 and 1, 0 included and 1 not included, which is the fractional part. So any real number, or any actually in this case, is a rational number really, is the floor of that real number or rational number plus the fractional part of that real number, which is basically greater than or equal with 0, but strictly less than 1. Now, if we look at the sum of x and y, is the sum of the two floors, floor of x and floor of y, plus the sum of the fractional parts of x and y. Similarly, if we look at the sum of x and y, we can rewrite it as the floor of x plus y plus the fractional part of x plus y. So if we want to look at that property, is the floor, the sum of the floors equal with the sum of the floor of the sum? We are actually looking at, is it true that in all cases, the sum of the fractional parts is equal with the fractional part of the sum? And we can immediately notice that no, that cannot be the case. So for the same question, we can immediately come with a counterexample where we look only at the fractional part, because we can see that if the fractional part in both cases is 1 divided by 2, then the sum of the fractional parts is 1, and the fractional part of the sum is 0, because x plus y, basically the sum of the fractional parts is 1 divided by 2 plus 1 divided by 2, which is equal with 1, but the fractional part of the sum was 1, and the fractional part of the sums are basically 0 plus 0. So let me extend it. This, the fractional, the sum of the fractional parts is 1 divided by 2 plus 1 divided by 2, which is 1. And the fractional part of that sum, if the sum is 1, and the fractional part, what is left, is 0. So really, we leave it at 0, and we can see that the two sums cannot be the same. Now, proving another property of floor. So for any real number x and for all integers m, the floor of x plus m is equal with the floor of x plus m. Now, again, in order to prove such a property, we have to prove it in the with the method of generalizing from a particular but arbitrarily chosen numbers. So suppose that x is a particular but arbitrarily chosen real number. So some real number that has an integer part and a fractional part. If m is also a particular but arbitrarily chosen integer, so m is some integer. If n is the floor of x, then basically by definition of floor, n is an integer with the property that n is less than equal with x, and strictly where n x is strictly less than n plus 1. Now, in both these inequalities, we are adding m. And we know inequality, adding on both sides keeps the same inequality as we had before. So we basically get that m plus 1 is less than equal with x plus m, which is strictly less than n plus m plus 1. But this is exactly the definition of the floor of x plus m. The floor of x plus m is therefore m plus n, which now is equal with, by the definition that n was the floor of x, with the floor of x plus m, which is exactly what we need to prove, that the floor of a real number x plus an integer m is the floor of the real number plus m. And that's it. Basically, we proved it using the method of direct proof and the definitions of floor. Okay. So again, if you prove any such properties in the exam, you have to be very explicit. You have to specify what is arbitrarily chosen and but a particular element, and then the definitions that you use step by step to prove the property. Now, the floor of n divided by 2 is equal with, and now our property is that for any integer n, if n is an even number, then the floor of n divided by 2 is n divided by 2. Otherwise, if n is an odd number, then the floor of n divided by 2 is n minus 1 divided by 2. Basically, the previous number which was even divided by 2. So let's again use the method of generalizing from a particular, but proving by cases. So suppose that n is a particular but arbitrarily chosen integer. There are two possible cases. N is odd and n is even, because we know that odd numbers are those that it's some integer multiplied with 2 plus 1, or is an even number, is some integer multiplied with 2. If n is odd, then n is equal with 2k plus 1 for some integer k. The floor of n divided by 2 is the floor of 2k plus 1 divided by 2, which is the floor of 2k divided by 2 plus 1 divided by 2. And now we have the floor of k plus 1 divided by 2, which is basically, we can already see that this is an integer k, and this is the fractional part, which was 1 divided by 2. So the fractional part, because this is an integer, will be basically equal with k. This was one of the properties that we proved before. Now, n minus 1 divided by 2 is 2k plus 1, which was the same n minus 1 divided by 2, which is equal with 2k divided by 2, which is equal with k. So we have the same value. Therefore, we can see that the floor of n divided by 2 is indeed n minus 1 everything divided by 2. Okay, sorry about that. Divided by 2. Now, if n is even, then basically n is equal with 2k or for some integer k. And the floor of n divided by 2 is basically n divided by 2, because n divided by 2, by the definition of even, is an integer. No, it's k. And therefore, the floor of that is equal with k itself. So let me actually do it step by step. So n divided by 2, the floor of that is equal with the floor of k, which is equal with k because k was an integer. But we already showed that we started with the fact that n is equal with 2k. Therefore, n is equal with n divided by 2 is equal with k. Okay. So this is what we need to prove, that basically, let me color it specially, the floor of n divided by 2, if n is even, is equal with n divided by 2. Okay. So that's basically it. Therefore, just to leave the final formula. Okay, let's actually see if there are any questions. No? Okay, let's continue. So earlier we had the property, and that property basically said that if you divide by 4, you are getting basically one of the possibilities that a number, an integer, is 4q or 4q plus 1 or 4q plus 2 or 4q plus 3. Let's now try to prove the unique existence of the quotient and the remainder in an integer division. So if n is any integer and d is a positive integer, then the quotient is the floor of n divided by d. And the remainder is n minus d multiplied with the floor of n divided by t. And if these two, then n is equal with d multiplied with q plus r, and r is greater than or equal with 0 and strictly less than d. So again, we use the method of direct proof. Suppose n is any integer and d is a positive integer, with the properties that we had above, that q is defined as n, the floor of n divided by d, and r is defined as n minus d multiplied with the floor of n divided by d. Now, but we can compute the formula d multiplied with q plus r, and that will be equal with, by the definition, we'll basically have that is d multiplied with the floor of n divided by d plus n minus d multiplied with n divided by d. Okay. And now we can actually open the parentheses. So n d multiplied with n divided by d minus d minus d multiplied with floor of n divided by d will cancel each other. So this will be equal with n. Also, by the definition of floor, we basically have that q is equal with, it's less than equal with n divided by d, which is less than q plus 1. We can multiply all of this with the positive integer d. So we get d multiplied with q is less than equal with n, which is less than d multiplied with q plus d. We can subtract d multiplied with q, in which case we get 0 is less than equal with n minus d multiplied with q, but q was equal with the floor of n divided by d, which is less than d. But this is actually the definition of remainder. So the remainder was equal with n minus d multiply with n with the floor of n divided by d. So basically now we have that r is greater than or equal with 0 and strictly less than d, which is what we wanted to show. So we suppose those two integers that were true and the two formulas, the two additional equalities, and let me put it here so it's clear. And then we actually showed that additional formula, okay, to be true, the two formulas to be true. So basically what we got from this theorem is really that the quotient is the floor of the division and the remainder is the rest of that division. Now there are also indirect proofs, and there are two types of indirect proofs that we will prove. So proof by contradiction or reductio impossibly or ad absurdum. And really it means that a statement is true or if it is false, but not both. Assume that the statement is false. If the assumption that the statement was false leads logically to a contradiction, impossible or absurdity, then that assumption must be false. Hence the original statement must have been true. And let's prove the fact that there is no greatest integer. So we assume that by contradiction, there is a greatest integer n. N is greater than lowercase n for any integer n. If there is such a greatest integer, and in this formula, we can add 1 to it. And basically, another proof, and actually that's probably easier to show, is that if there is such an integer and 1 is greater than or equal to 0, we could add n to that inequality. And we obtain a greater integer. We obtain that n plus 1 is greater than n. And this is a contradiction because we assume that there is no greatest integer. And that was our initial assumption. In fact, that's basically an easy proof. Okay. No integer can be both even and odd at the same time. This was a property that we left earlier for later. And suppose that there is at least one integer n, and this both even and odd. So by definition of even, we get that n is equal with 2a for some integer a. And by definition of odd, we get that n is equal with 2b plus 1 for some integer b. From the fact that both of these values are equal with n, we get that 2a is equal with 2b plus 1. We can subtract on both sides 2b, and we are getting that 2a minus 2b is equal with 1. We can divide both parts with 2, in which case we get that a minus b is equal with 1 divided by 2. But remember that we said that integers are closed under subtraction, and a minus b, therefore, must be also an integer. So we have an integer equal something that is not an integer. Therefore, we reach the contradiction, which must be the case that the original statement must have been true, have been false. No integer can be both even and odd at the same time. Next, the sum of a rational number and an irrational number is an irrational number. Okay. Before we continue with irrational numbers, this is a totally different area that we'll prove properties for. Let's see if there are any questions about rational numbers and divisibility and floor and ceiling that we discussed up to now. Okay, I see that there are no questions, so let's continue. So the property that we want to prove is that the sum of any rational number and irrational number is irrational. In particular, the logical formula for all real numbers R and S, if R is rational and S is irrational, then R plus S is irrational. Remember what rational was. Rational meant that there exists a fraction of two integers that is equal with that number in order to be rational. Irrational is not rational. So basically, there is no such pair of two integers such that their divisions is equal with original number. Of course, remember the other property in both cases that the denominator cannot be equal with zero. Now, assume that its negation is true. So basically, we want to prove this property, and instead of proving the property, we are proving that its negation is false. So the negation of that for all statement is there exists a rational number R and irrational number S, such that R plus S is rational. Assume that is true. So now we arbitrarily choose two numbers, a rational number R, such that is equal with A divided by B for some integers A and B different than zero. R plus S will now be equal with C divided by D, the basically the second condition in this existential statement. So R plus S is equal with C divided by D for some integers C and D is different than zero. S will be equal with R minus C divided by D minus R, which is C divided by D minus A divided by B, which is equal with, after multiplying the first fraction with B and the second one with D and adding the fractions with common denominator, we get B multiplied with C minus A multiplied with D divided by B divided by D, B multiplied with D. But B and D are both different than zero, so therefore their product is different than zero. And we actually got the definition of a rational number. So S must be a rational number, which contradicts the supposition that S is an irrational number. Therefore, it must be that the negation of that existential statement is false, which makes the original statement true. Okay. So we use the method of direct proof within a proof by contradiction. Next, argument by contraposition. So remember one thing, that the contrapositive of an implication is equivalent with that implication. So we have the standard implication for all x in D, P of x implies Q of x, is equivalent with this contrapositive for all x in D. If Q of x is false, then P of x is false. We prove the contrapositive as a direct proof, and that actually makes the original statement also true. So in order to prove the contrapositive, suppose that x is particularly arbitrarily chosen element in the domain D, such that Q of x is false, and infer from that that P of x is also false. That makes the contrapositive true, which actually makes by logical equivalence the original statement to be true. And let's use it to prove the following statement. If the square of an integer is even, then the integer must be even. Okay? The contrapositive of that statement is for all integers n, if n is an odd number, then the square of that number is odd. So we took basically the negation of the statement, basic original statement. Suppose n is an odd number. By definition of odd number, n must be equal with 2k plus 1 for some integer k. Then n square will be 2k plus 1 square, which is 4k square plus 2k plus 2k plus 1. which is 4k squared plus 4k plus 1. We can give 2 as a common factor in the first two, in the first sum, and we are getting that is equal with 2 multiplied with 2k squared plus 2k plus 1. But 2k squared plus 2k is an integer, and multiplied with 2 is an integer. Therefore, basically, an integer, this number plus 1 is an odd number. Okay. Actually, here I should have said that this number with 1 multiplied with 2 is an integer, which makes this an odd number. Okay. So we proved the counter positive, which actually proves the original statement. Okay. Okay. Contradiction example. If the square of an integer is even, then the integer is even. Suppose the negation of that theorem. So the negation of this universal statement is there is an integer n such that n squared is even and n is not even. Now, any integer is either even or odd, no? Then by the quotient remainder theorem, with d equal with 2, since n is not even, it's not even, it is odd. So basically we have n is equal with 2k plus 1 for some integer k. N square will be equal with 2k plus 1 square, which is 4k square plus 4k plus 1, which is 2 multiplied with 2k square plus 2k, which is an integer, plus 1. Therefore, n square is odd. So the same property can be proven by contraposition, or it can be proven as basically by contradiction. Suppose the negation is true, and then show that the negation, in order to be true, it must have been basically its contraposition, its original statement must have been false. Next statement is about the real number square of 2. So let's see if there are any questions before we continue again. No questions. Number theory is hard, but really, like, you have to practice a lot with real problems to see the actual proof. So first of all, what is square root of 2? So basically, you have the standard definition that C is the side of a right triangle with is one of the sides of the one triangle with sides the other two sides equal with 1. So 1 square plus 1 square is equal with 2, and basically C square is equal with 2, which makes C equal with square root of 2. So we basically get C square is equal with 2. So the length of the diagonal in a square of size of 1 divided by the side is C divided by 1, which is square root of 2 divided by 1, which is square root of 2. Now, for this value, square root of 2, we want to basically prove that it is a rational number. It's not a rational number. Suppose the negation. So prove by contradiction. Suppose that square root of 2 is rational and that there exist two integers, m and n, with no common factors, the unique way to write a ration, such that square root of 2 is m divided by n, and n is different than 0. That's another part of this part of the rational number. Now, m square is equal with 2 multiplied with n square, because we can raise both of them to square. It implies that m square is even, basically by the previous theorem, that if the number is even, the square of a number is even, if and only if the number is even. Therefore, m is equal with 2k. Therefore, m squared is equal with 2k squared, which is 4 multiplied with k squared, which is equal with 2 multiplied with n squared. So therefore, n squared is equal with 2k squared, so n squared is also even. But also by the proof that we saw before, n must be even. So m and n are both even, so they both have a common factor of 2. But our supposition was that we wanted to choose these two numbers in a unique way such that they don't have any common factor that could have been eliminated. So we get a contradiction. M and n are both factors of 2, where we started that they are not factors of 2. They are not factors of each other. They don't have common factors. Therefore, our assumption that square root of 2 is rational is false, and square root of 2 is irrational. Okay. Next property. Let's prove by contradiction that the set of all prime numbers is finite is false. So we want to prove that the set of all prime numbers is finite. Proof, suppose that the set of prime numbers is finite and there is some prime number p that is the largest of all the prime numbers. So we have the sequence of prime numbers. 2 is prime number, 3, 5, 7, 11, and so on up to p. Let's consider n to be equal with 2 multiply with 3 multiply with 5 multiply with 7 multiply with 11 up to p plus 1. But this number, n greater than 1, is divisible. It's by definition, since n is not a prime number, and the theorem, the unique factorization theorem, is n must be equal with a product of some prime numbers to some powers. So n, by the definition, must have been divisible by some prime number q in from 2 to p. But q, therefore, divides 2 multiply with 3 multiply with 5 up to p. However, it doesn't divide 2 multiply with 3 multiply with 5 multiply with 7 up to p plus 1. So it's also proven by contradiction. I will not get into that. But basically, now we show a contradiction that if n is that product of all of the prime numbers up to p plus 1, it cannot be divided by one of the previous primes. Therefore, this is also a prime number that basically we just found is the product of the prime numbers plus 1. So basically, the set of prime numbers is infinite, because assuming that it's finite will get us another prime number which was not considered in the set that is greater than the previous prime numbers. Okay. Application to number theory are algorithms. And basically, a variable from algorithms is really a specific location in memory. These variables are given a data type, so we cannot choose, like, for instance, reals or integers that are infinite. We have to give it a finite set. There are also variables that represent characters, which are really numbers because the encoding of those characters are through numbers. Similarly for strings, Boolean values can be encoded as two numbers, 0 or 1. Assignment statements are those statements in which a variable is assigned the value of an expression after it's evaluated. Conditional statements are if-then-else statements. If a condition is true, then we execute a statement 1, otherwise we execute a statement 2, and then we continue. And the condition is evaluated by substituting the current values for all of the variables occurring in it, and evaluating that logical formula to true or false. Loops are also inserted. So here is an example of an algorithm that simply checks a condition and then executes different parts of the code if that condition was true or false. Iterative statements are those are loops. Loops are basically like an if statement, but if the condition maintains to be true, we re-execute the body of that loop, the statements within the while and the end of the while statement in this case. And really what you can do is to implement a lot of algorithms using loops, including one of the most important algorithms that we have in number theory, which is the Euclidean algorithm for computing the greatest common divisor of two integers. So first of all, let's define the greatest common divisor of two integers. Is the integer d, that is the highest integer d that basically divides, d is the common divisor of both a and b, so it divides a and divides b. And for all other integers c, if c is a common divisor of a and b, then c is less than or equal with d. So for all integers, we write it in logic, for all integers c, if c divides a and c divides b, then c must be less than equal with the greatest common divisor d of a and b. So for instance, the greatest common divisor of 72 and 63 is actually the greatest common divisor between the product of 9 and 8 and the product of 9 and 7. And we see that 7 and 8 have no common factors, so the greatest common divisor is really 9. If r is a positive integer, then the greatest common divisor between 0 and r is equal with r. And the Euclidean algorithm is one of the oldest algorithms that appears in writing, and it was invented 300 years before our era. And really, what it basically, it's an algorithm for computing the greatest common divisor. If a and b are integers, but not both zero, and if q and r are any integers such that a is equal with b multiplied with q plus r, then the greatest common divisor of a and b is equal with the greatest common divisor of b and r. So basically, we are using the quotient and the remainder to compute the next step, to have an algorithm that iterates from two big numbers slower towards basically digit numbers and finding the correct remainder, the correct common divisor, greatest common divisor. And here is the algorithm that does that. Basically, it contains a while loop that stops, this is supposed to be here. Good. I just want to show the inequality. Okay. And what it does, it iterates until b is equal with zero, and a will be the greatest common divisor at the end. I will not get into algorithms. Basically, this is just to show you that number theory is useful for implementation of algorithms. This class is mainly about the definitions and proofs, and I want to concentrate on that. So this is just to show you algorithms written in a pseudocode. So the rest of the lecture today will be problems in the recitation. And let me stop the recording of the lecture. I see that there are no additional questions.